Welcome back to After the Fact. We're still joined by Bayan Muna Party List Representative Carlos Arate and former Governor Lito Coscolluela. Okay, I'd like to ask former Governor Coscolluela, has Senator Pinlacson actually submitted himself to the selection process of the 1Sambayan coalition?
Each potential candidate has to be nominated by someone. Okay. I would presume that a potential candidate can find ways to get a nomination. Then the nomination is submitted to the conveners, and this will then be subjected to the so-called selection process. Okay. And there are four criteria: character, competence, track record, and the ability to wage a viable national campaign. Maraming kasama dyan sa loob ng apat na yon. In fact, medyo madugo nga eh. If we get down to actually discussing individual nominees. But these four criteria will help us determine the most suitable candidate for the opposition. Okay?
So officially, hindi pa siya kasama sa selection process?
If I'm not mistaken, Senator Lacson might have been nominated, but he initially declined the nomination because I think he might have been told that some members of the conveners group were against his position regarding the anti-terror law. Diba? And therefore he said, "Ay, kung ayaw nila sa akin, di wag na lang." So okay. That is what might have happened. And this has not been made public. Okay, so now, in fact, his having this conversation with Vice President Lenny came as a surprise to me because he, in fact, had already been campaigning in the provinces. In fact, I was approached by some of his followers who asked if I would consider joining them. And I said, "I'm sorry, I have..."
Okay. Congressman Zarate, in this case, actually we've heard that statement before coming from Senator Lacson. But in this case, do you get the feeling that those so-called viable candidates for the opposition, are they actually taking this 1Sambayan process seriously?
I cannot second guess how they consider 1Sambayan, no? But this is the process now being taken by 1Sambayan and the group
candidate in mind. Okay.
Go ahead, Congressman Sarada. Yeah.
And the groups inside 1Sambayan is a serious process, no? So it's nasa ano yan, nasa mga individual personalities yan, no? How they will take 1Sambayan.
And that's true. That's true, Congressman Zarate. But my question is this: basically, we know how the political realities are here in the Philippines, and even if there's such selection process from within the opposition forces or groups, we know that that won't preclude anybody from this same coalition to actually run their campaign or to actually file their COCs for president this October, because this is more of a personal ambition than to subject oneself to a process. I mean, we can talk about until tomorrow about the need to, for example, change this government, make sure that Duterte's candidate would be defeated in 2022. But in the end, personal ambition is still a very big factor for someone's decision to run or not for president in 2022.
Mm. Well, that is true, Christian, no? But at least for us, hindi tayo ultimate later on be charged or accused of, you know, just letting this thing pass without trying to come up with a broader coalition that will run against the Duterte clique, no? Kasi pag hindi mo rin itinuloy itong process na ito, however painstaking it is, challenging it is, by default, talo na tayo. No? Talagang sinasabi na natin that the next 6 years will give it the silver platter to the Duterte clique, no? So that they can continue their governance. So
pero
again,
yung situation na you have a candidate for Isambayan, but you also have at least two other candidates who are not necessarily with the opposition, who are not necessarily with the administration, but candidates still. Kasi ganun ang proseso natin, di ba? Usually, minority president ang nananalo. That situation, do you think that would work against the opposition or not? Exactly.
It will work both ways, no? Depending on who these candidates will be in the final run. No? We have an experience like this in 2004, for example. No? There are those groups na talagang gusto magsama-sama to prevent an extension of the presidency of President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo. But we know what happened, no? So I think we should learn a lesson from that. But of course, we cannot prevent even for example, this process being undertaken by Sambayan now will be a successful one. Of course, that is not a guarantee that eventually some personalities or some groups will till the end continue to be with the coalition. That is a reality in the in this kind of process, no? Especially in an election okay. process. So we just have to live with that situation, Christian.
Okay, Governor Coscolluela, I think you're back. Yeah. So it's the same question regarding that. Do you get the sense, based on your conversation with the so-called viable candidates for the opposition in 2022, do you get the sense that they're actually taking your process seriously?
Yes, because we're asking them to sign this statement of commitment. Okay, when somebody of that caliber puts his signature on a commitment letter, you would have to presume that they're serious. Okay, we have no choice but to accept that, you know, they're going to be serious. But again, going back to your earlier statement about Isambayan surfacing, you know, from out of nowhere and you know being self-proclaimed, first of all, if Isambayan did not surface, this talk about a united opposition may not have surfaced at all. Okay, and you would probably see four or five different candidates already beginning to campaign. So I think we're on the right track. We're trying to assemble a united opposition. It's not easy, madugo na proseso, but again, as I said, we have to start somewhere. And we're just hoping we can succeed. Again, there are many realities we need to face and the basic questions we need to answer. Sino ba talagang opposition? Are we willing to accept compromise? Are we willing to accept new allies in order to achieve the primary target? These are questions that we really need to answer from a realistic perspective.
Who have actually signed this commitment statement? Dun sa mga viable candidates that Isambayan is considering, sino na talaga yung pumirma?
For president?
Yeah.
So far, the only candidate for, or nominee for president who has actually been interviewed, actually we'd like to call it having a conversation with the nominee.
Was? Okay. Medyo suspense muna yung sagot ni former...
Is Sunny Trillanes.
Okay.
Am I back? No, I'm going to disappear again.
You're back.
Okay. Right. So,
si Senator Trillanes pa lang yung ano yung pumirma ng commitment.
Yes, and of course we're waiting for the commitment of Vice President Lenny. But again, as she said, she is not yet prepared to.
Okay, sige. Balikan natin mamaya si...
issue a statement. One thing I did hear, however, is that she might August 17 or 18.
Okay. But yeah. Governor, what does that tell you? That less than 2 months before the filing of the COCs, October 1 to 8, si former Senator Trillanes pa lang yung talagang very openly, talagang yeah. pumirma dun sa commitment na yun. What does that tell you?
Number one, that the wannabes, the presidential wannabes or the possible candidates do not want to expose themselves too early. Knowing the reality that once you expose yourself, once you announce that you're running for president, you're going to be the victim of heavy traffic from trolls. You're going to be demonized. You're going to be attacked left and right. And this is the signal we're getting from various nominees, even for senator. They don't want to announce too early because they're going to become targets. Okay. So this is very frustrating for me personally and for a lot of other people I know who want to know already sino ba talaga ang manok natin. I think you've heard a lot of people saying mahirap tumaya ngayon dahil wala pa tayong manok, di ba? And you know, this is a real problem. I think what's happened at this time is that the decisions for the presidency in 2022 have come much earlier, unusually early. Okay. So we're all feeling the frustration, but nobody wants to get exposed now.
Okay, we understand that, yung fear of being bashed early. We saw that in the case of former Vice President Jeju Marbinay. He declared early. He was attacked much earlier. Anyway, I'd like to go to Congressman Zarate. Speaking of refusing to expose one's ambitions early, that's quite the opposite in the case of Senator Bong Go and President Rodrigo Duterte, who are expected to be nominated by the ruling PDP Laban Party as their presidential and vice presidential candidates in 2022. What do you think of this tandem? Go Duterte, Congressman Zarate.
Mute.
Yeah, you're on mute, sir. Congressman Zarate, you're on mute.
Yeah. Thank you, Christian. This is the very reason why we don't want another 6 years of Duterte governance, no? Because even if it is Senator Bongo who will be the presidential candidate, you see how the tandem the Go and Duterte is doing, no? In the past 6 months or in the past 6 years, no? But to me, this is just another variant of the Duterte clique, no? Or the Duterte administration leading towards 2022, May 2022 election. Some may look at it as just a ploy, perhaps, no? But the real objective is to extremely push for a candidate of the administration, no? Whether that's Senator Bongo or the daughter of President Duterte, Mayor Sara. So these are things that are still very fluid right now. And when October 1 comes, then we will know, no? But learning from the 2016 election, Christian, alam naman natin kung ano ang ginawa, no, ng grupo ni Mayor Duterte. He did not, in fact, file his certificate of candidacy in October of 2016. What happened was just
a substitute.
So this can be a variation of that ploy to misdirect or to mislead our people as to who truly is the candidate of President Duterte for the May 2022 election.
Okay.
Because it's also, if this is a survival for us, it's also a survival for President Duterte, no? Knowing, for example, that he's facing a case, for example, at the ICC.
Yeah.
and okay. other cases.
Okay. Finally, Governor Coscolluela, I'd like to hear your thoughts on this. Do you consider this as a formidable tandem, Go Duterte? And what do you think of the competence of Senator Bong Go as a possible presidential candidate?
That's exactly what I was going to say, Christian. No? If you subject Senator Bong Go to the criteria of 1Sambayan, he would fail. Competence, character, and track record, absolutely nothing to show. Okay, so if he were to be subjected to the same selection process that we're using, he would be immediately booted out. So, in fact, pwede nating sabihin medyo nakakahiya na mag-aambisyon ang isang tao na wala naman talagang maipakita. On the other hand, the Senate, or rather the President, who they say is going to run for Vice President, to me this sounds like a shameless attempt to retain power. Para sa akin, you know, one term as president is enough. Running for vice president clearly shows that he intends to hold on to power, and that just should not be acceptable.
Okay. Former Governor Lito Coscolluela and Bayan Muna Party List Representative Carlos Zarate, thank you very much, gentlemen, for joining us tonight on the program.
Thank you, Krista.
And before we go, social media users are divided over Senator Panfilo Lacson's so-called unification formula for the 2022 elections. Some netizens believe it could just be a ploy for Lacson in the end. Others are in favor of the formula, including former Comelec Commissioner Goyo Larrazabal, who called it selfless. But one user questions whether Lacson could really honor the deal, even after telling ANC last week that there was no turning back for him and his running mate, Senate President Vicente Soto III. And that's it for this episode. I'm Christian Esguerra. You can watch this episode again on iWantTFC or listen to our podcast on Spotify. Now for recaps and other exclusive content, subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel and catch up with us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. See you again tomorrow after the fact.